रेस्पेक्टेड डियर फैमिली मेंबर्स, माय प्रणाम्स टू यू. लास्ट वीक व्हेन आई वाज एक्सप्लेनिंग डिफरेंट सब्जेक्ट डिफरेंट पॉइंट्स इंक्लूडिंग स्पिरिचुअलिटी साइकोलॉजी रिलीजियन साइंस इंडियन हेरिटेज विच आई यूज टू upload in the YouTube in Malayalam. After converting it into English language, when I uploaded in as a nutshell, many people appreciated it and they said every subject is to be converted into English and it should be uploaded like this. So I thought in a nutshell I can upload about 15 to 20 subjects at a stretch, so that on Sundays or other days, holidays or evening, those who cannot follow Malayalam can understand it, analyze it and disseminate that knowledge to your family members or friends. So the first point what I want to say is, many people think that without the knowledge of Sanskrit one cannot learn Hinduism or Indian heritage. I would like to very specifically say, for our level, for your level, understanding Hinduism, understanding Indian heritage, whatever may be the subject, whether it is mathematics or astronomy or metallurgy, whatever may be the subject, a thorough knowledge of Sanskrit is not at all needed. Almost all the books available in Sanskrit, they have got converted into, translated into Hindi, English and some of them to the regional languages also. So many people use it as an excuse to say that I want to learn Bhagavad Gita from the original text. You need not wait for understanding, for learning Bhagavad Gita from the original text. Excellent commentaries and interpretations are available. Go through that one. So some people used to say, I don't know Sanskrit, so how can I learn in Hinduism? All the books are written in Sanskrit. That is also wrong. That is merely an excuse, or it's taken as a running away from the fact. For learning Hinduism, for understanding Hindu Dharma, for understanding our culture, a thorough knowledge of Sanskrit is not needed. If you have got the knowledge of Sanskrit, very good. So try to learn everything whatever I told you from the book, either in English available, Motilal Banarsidas, Chaukamma Publications, and many books are published by local people. Maybe little bit of problems will be there. Don't worry about it. For our level, that is enough. Next point, about Dhanurveda. What is Dhanurveda? There is no book available nowadays, I think. Dhanurveda book is not available. But many literature informs us that Dronacharya has written a book known as Dhanurveda. Dhanurveda, the subject matter is science of archery. Science of archer. All the rules, norms of a war, battle, that is explained in Dhanurveda. Dhanurveda is the Upaveda of Yajurveda. Arthashastra is the Upaveda of Rigveda. Dhanurveda is the Upaveda of Yajurveda. Gandharva Veda is the Upaveda of Samaveda. Ayurveda is the Upaveda of Adharva Veda. So Dhanurveda book is not available. But very interestingly, all the contents explained in Dhanurveda that we can get from Yuddha Parva of Mahabharata. From Mahabharata, all the rules and regulations connected with the battle, they are available, so that one can understand this Dhanurveda from Mahabharata. Next point, one of my experiences. three years ago, I think, on January 26th, Republic Day, IIM Bangalore, Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore, they had a one-day workshop for extremely high level of officers from corporate sector, Tata Company, BSNL, and Reliance Company. 98 delegates were there. I was given the subject, pre-dinner session subject, Vedic management. Vedic management, many, many quotations from Vedas, some quotations from Bhagavad Gita, many quotations from Upanishads. I explained for 1 hour. The time given to me was 1 hour, 60 minutes sharp. The coordinator told me, 60th minute you have to stop. But when I was explaining with the slides and other thing, this Vedic management, exactly 60th minute I could see from the clock, I stopped it. One lady from Tata Company, Elizabeth, is a Christian, you know by name you can understand that. She said, first time we are listening to such a subject, so it should not be stopped. You continue that. And I continued for 3 hours. So 180 minutes after that I stopped. So really, 99.9% of the people said, for the first time we are listening to the subject of Vedic management. And something super, what is the need of the hour is Vedic management, particularly in India. Wheresoever these are all applicable. So, but in India, this is very important. So what I wanted to convey you, when you give any heritage subject in such a way that the listener can understand and adopt in their life, they will take it, even though it is religious or non-religious. The messages are very, very important, adoptable and adaptable in the 21st century. So try to learn, try to teach in the wavelength of the people who are sitting in front of you, so that those knowledge, heritage knowledge, are adoptable in the 21st century for the modern management, for enriching our day-to-day life. So utilize the heritage knowledge for the modern society, not merely for going to heaven or to erase of your sin, but to create a heaven in this world. Use Indian heritage. Next message from Baxter Carolina. She is from California University. She came to Kerala and stayed in a village, in a traditional house, where the children used to chant kirtans and bhajans late evening after taking the bath. When Baxter Carolina, the professor, was there in the home, the children chanted the kirtan in a low voice, very low voice. Then the grandmother said, why you are chanting the kirtan and bhajan at low voice? You chant it in a loud voice as usual. Then Baxter Carolina, that lady, asked the grandmother, what is the purpose of chanting it in a higher voice, louder voice? Immediately grandmother said, when we chant the kirtan or bhajan in a louder voice, mantras in a louder voice, the plants listen that and they will also get a moksha. This lady got a new idea from that. She went back to California. She had a beautiful garden, rose garden. Nearly 50-60 rose plants are there. Plants are there, were there. Both are correct. And after listening this grandma's message, she went back and she told the rose plants, you need not have to have the thorns, spines in you. I will protect you. Don't worry, no animal will come. Your full protection is assured. You can shed your spines or thorns. After 2 months, 60-70 days, she could see that the rose plant having thorns in that, the new branches coming did not have the thorns, did not have the spine in that. So human messenger can be taken by the plants. This is from a traditional information. In my home, there was a breadfruit tree. For about 5-6 years, it was standing like that. One day I went there, after listening to Baxter Carolina's experience, I continuously told this tree, if you are not giving me the fruit, breadfruit, I will cut you. There is no other alternative for me. You know, that year, I got 220 breadfruit from that. You know, Vishu day, it is when the sun moves from Meenam Rashi to Madam Rashi, that particular Mesha Sankranti, Vishu, Surya television channel recorded my message sitting in front of this breadfruit tree. Many people who watched that TV message, they called me and said, how you got so many breadfruits in one tree? So our messages the plant take. Even today, in front of my home, one coconut tree is there. Almost the coconut used to fall in the neighbor's tiles, the tiled house. Continuously I told this coconut tree, lean towards this side, lean towards this side. Now not even a single tender coconut or piece of something will be falling there. Everything will be falling on my home. The coconut which grew like this, formerly it was going to the other side because no shade was there. Now you can see sharply it twisted like this. So our messages will be taken by plants. Next point, Hanuman effect. You know, in Ramayana we have got Hanuman effect. What is the Hanuman effect, you know? When a boy, girl, a man, completely depressed, having inferiority complex, or due to ignorance, or due to some other reason, if he is completely depressed, you go on motivating him or her, continuously motivate. A critical stage will come when this man, this girl, this boy crosses the critical level, his, her performance will be something super. He will be behaving like a genius. Just like Hanuman did not have the confidence of jumping to Lanka, when Jambavan motivated, a stage came when Hanuman said that, I will not only jump to the other side without any problem, I can come back also. Thus through motivation, appreciation, blessing, guiding, encouraging, even the limitation of an individual can be erased off. That is what is known as Hanuman effect. Next point, Abhimanyu effect. Right from the second month of conceiving, a pregnant woman continuously listen Veda mantra, good messages, good songs, and very positive mind, keep positive mind, you can see that the baby will be absorbing that. And many messages, many mantras, it will be creating an extremely positive impact on the baby. This in the West is known as Abhimanyu effect. You know, when Subhadra was conceiving Abhimanyu, Lord Krishna explained many things that baby could understand. At that stage it could be conceived or not, that is different. But that concept could be extrapolated even today. All the pregnant women should listen to mantras, kirtans, bhajans, good songs, prayers, so that it will be definitely having a positive effect in the baby in their womb. Next point. 3 years back, I was in New York. 2 months back also, I had gone to New York. Not 2 months, 1 month back. Last month, I was in New York. And I went for attending Kerala Hindus of North America. KHNA Hindu Conference. I could meet one doctor, George Martin. People used to call him, they were telling, Chanakya of heart surgery. He was called as Chanakya of heart surgery. This George Martin had in New York heart surgical hospital also. He has purchased all the four Vedas from me. 200 hours. Rigveda, Krishna Yajurveda, Shukla Yajurveda, Samaveda, Adharma Veda. 5 Vedas. Yajurveda, 2 branches, 2 recensions. I asked him why you are purchasing these Vedas. He said, 24 hours in my hospital, I play Vedas. So that those who are going to undertake the surgery, those who just completed the heart surgery, those who are post-surgical treatment, all of them will be having a very soothing effect, neuro-linguistic effect, even though they don't understand the meaning of the Vedas. The Shruti of the Veda, the chanting of the Veda creates curative chemicals in their brain, and that will be giving a very smoothening effect. Just like music therapy, mantra therapy will affect their body. So George Martin's experience, another professor, Professor T. Temple Tuttler from Cleveland University, he came to Trivandrum, he stayed in my home, and we went to regional cancer center and some other hospital, and he delivered a lecture there and told the director of the hospital that you should put Veda mantra cassette in every room so that the curing effect will be fantastic. And that Professor T. Temple Tuttler has taken his PhD from Tyagaraja Kirtan, and he has conducted 28 years of research on the effect of mantras and Indian music on psychological and physiological changes. It's an excellent experience for us. Now, next point, what I just want to say. You know, it's an entirely different subject. Variety of subject I am telling to you. The Muslims in Tamil Nadu. This year, Muslim League was standing with the Congress and the DMK. 5 Muslim League MLAs were there contesting. Only one could win the seat. They were sharply opposing Jayalalitha of AIADMK throughout Tamil Nadu. But just after the election, the results declared after 15 days, Ramzan period came. Now also it is Ramzan period. These Muslims went to Jayalalitha and requested that more than 6,000 mosques are there in Tamil Nadu. 6,000 mosques. The Ramzan food should be sponsored by the Tamil Nadu government as good quality rice. Good quality rice should be given to the mosques free of cost for all the 6,000 mosques. Immediately she agreed for that. You just see, even though the Muslims contested against AIADMK and Jayalalitha, they know how to get their things done. Hindus should also do like this. Whether it is Congress, whether it is CPM, whether it is AIADMK, whether it is Samajwadi party or Janata Dal party, Hindus should go and get their things done, just like Christians and Muslims are doing their level best for getting their things done, whosoever may be sitting in the ruling chair. Now next point, Mohenjo-daro and Harappa. It's an entirely different subject. You know, English people, when Britishers were ruling India, they always kept in their mind that Indian culture, Indian civilization, Vedas, archaeological evidences, whatsoever may be available, to give information and knowledge about Indian civilization. It should never go beyond 2000 BC. 2000 BC should never go beyond that. So they fixed the Vedic period as 500 BC, Ramayana as 200 BC, Puranas as 100 BC or even AD, and like that, everything. They fixed the period of Mohenjo-daro, Chinchu-daro, Harappa, Kalibangan, Bhagwanpura, Mehargarh and so on. Also, some 1000 BC, 700 BC, 1200 BC or something like that. Never they allowed it to go beyond that. Do you know what is the reason? According to Bible, Jesus Christ happened to be the 99th generation of Adam and Eve. 99th generation of Adam and Eve. Say for example, 100th generation. Then what will happen? One generation, maybe 25 or 30 years. So, maximum 25 years or 30 years. So, 100th generation backwards from Jesus Christ is 2500 or 3000 years. So, anything in the world should happen only after Adam and Eve. So, the maximum possible period is 3000 BC. But in somewhere, people calculated it as 4012 BC, Adam was born and Eve was also born. 4012 BC. For the sake of our discussion, let us take 4000 BC. No Christian, no Britishers, nobody who follow, who think Bible is the religious book, allowed any other civilization to go beyond 3500 BC. Because Adam, next generation, and so on. Then only the people will become cultured and the civilization can be formed. But you know, 3 years back, one human body intact could be brought, taken out from the deep ice heap from Ural mountain of Italy. That human body was 69,000 year old. 69,000 year old. And one skull could be excavated from Mongolia 2 million years old. Now many human bodies are excavated 10,000, 20,000, 30,000, 40,000 years. So the so-called crooked story of Adam and Eve, it got wiped out. It got wiped out, and the real calculation of the cultures and civilizations are being done. So we could see that our Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, that civilization was flourishing here during 7000 BC, 6000 BC and so on. So Vedas were written far beyond that, 8000 BC and so on. So the Christians, even scholars, thinkers and Christian scientists, they oppressed, suppressed and depressed the facts that Indian civilization did not have the historical evidence beyond 1000 BC. Now, it's very clear that Indian civilization starts and existed like this as it is there now, right from BC 8275. So we should learn the Indian history through the Giger-Müller counter isotope study and the most modern scientific methodological pathway. So the Aryan invasion has got wiped out. There is nothing like Aryan invasion. There is nothing like Aryas and Dravida. All these theories which were taught to Indians by the Britishers through Lord Macaulay and Max Muller to cheat Indians and to make them think that English people, Britishers and Indians both belong to Aryan race, so that English people invading to India, ruling India, is nothing but the coming together of the two same race, two family of the same race. when Britishers are Aryans, Indians are Aryans, when British come here and rule India, it's the same Aryans. We are coming together, sharing together, caring together. For such creating such a an impression, a wrong pathway is created, and that Aryan invasion and the period of Mohenjo-Daro Harappa, the Aryan invasion theory got wiped out, created by Max Muller. He himself said it is wrong, but nobody listened it. Even in India, the Aryan invasion theory is still taught in the school books. Unfortunately, there is nothing like Aryan invasion. The period of Mohenjo-Daro Harappa, Kali Bangan, Bhagavanpura, everything goes beyond 7,000, 8,000 years back from now. So we should understand that. Next point. Getting an idea. It's a simple thing. You know, brainstorming is commonly practiced. Many violent suggestions used to be given by people. Why these violent suggestions are given? Because from among these suggestions, somebody can take one point and think, rethink, and do addition, division, modification, and correction, and then come at an excellent adoptable idea. In India, we have got 18 Purana, 18 Upapurana. We have got Mahabharata, we have got Ramayana, Vedas, Upanishads, Brahmanas, Aranyakas, Darshanas. When you read all these things, you may get some ideas. Variety of ideas, 360 degree searching. So our heritage may not be useful for adopting it as such. But addition, deletion and modification can be done. A number of serials could be brought out. Mahabharata serial, Ramayana serial and Purana serials. Many CDs could be produced. Computerization and animation could be done. So now Indian heritage, Indian literature, their messages, their stories, their experiences, the truth and fact about their life explained in Indian heritage. They have become a biggest business in China, in Japan, Thailand. Now it started becoming a business in India also. I am telling, keep your ears open, keep your eyes open, discuss with others. You will get hundreds and thousands of ideas from our heritage. From the modern science, you can utilize the technology and enrich our heritage and spread it as much as possible. Don't think that ideas will be coming only from the learned people. Albert Einstein did not have the formal education. And you know, Sir Isaac Newton was a priest, a church father. They can also get the ideas. Ideas can be available from anywhere, any book, any discussion, any movie, any serial, any baby, you can get it. So, take the idea, enrich yourself. Never get yourself stagnant. Be active, move forward, march forward. Stagnation is death, death is stagnation. And you know, life is growth, growth is life. Now coming to next point. Next point is keeping an open mind. Whether you are a Hindu, Christian or Muslim or a leftist or a rightist or a middleist, whether you are an atheist or believer, always keep an open mind. I am not giving you a discourse. I am not giving you a sermon. I am telling you, if you can keep your mind open, whatever you are listening, whatever you are watching, whatever you are discussing, what you are thinking, can be made useful for innovation, creativity, step change, and also for a meritorious life. Keep your mind open. Take the good and bad. Keep your ears open for listening good and bad. Keep your eyes open to watch good and bad. Keep your mind open to take only good. So when you are taking the good, I tell you that you will become a different man. You know, whatever happened yesterday, you cannot change. Past cannot be corrected. Part of the present and part of the future, full of the future, can be corrected. For correcting, information and knowledge are needed. Use the information and the knowledge to create wisdom, and use the wisdom to create a good experience. There you will change. Always keep your mind open. Never keep it in a biased way. Every criticism is a surgery. Every appreciation is like a massage. Massage will be having temporary effect. Criticism will be having long-standing effect. The bad is removed through surgery. So my request to you, whether you are bad man or good man, these are all immaterial. Our ultimate aim is moving from bad to good. Asadoma Satyamaya, Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya, Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya. For which listening, watching, discussing, thinking and keeping an open, transparent mind are needed. Hope you will do that one. Next point. When I was taking my MBA degree, 7th postgraduate degree MBA from ICFI Business School. Many people, many professors used to come for our contact class, which was taking place in IIT campus in Bombay. So one of the professors was telling us, good is there everywhere in the world. Even a bad man has got a good thing. A good man will also be having bad thing. Your ultimate aim should be to take good from everywhere. Your ultimate aim should be to take a good from everywhere. Have you heard about Ramana Maharshi? I think an interesting incident occurred in Thiruvannamalai, in the ashram of Ramana Maharshi. Some people came there and told him, Maharshi, when he had gone to the guest house, what we could see that guest house, people working in the guest house, they were fighting each other. When we went to the temple, we could see the priests were fighting each other. When we went to the canteen, which serving the food, the workers were grumbling and fighting each other. Why it is happening? What Ramana Maharshi told you, if you have come all the way for watching the fighting of the guest house people, for watching the fighting of the priest in the temple, for watching the fighting of the canteen people, you watch that and go. But if you have come for taking something else, to watch me and pray and to see me, discuss with me, do that and go. Negatives and positives will be there everywhere. If you want to take and watch and analyze the negative, do that. If you want to take the positive, do that. This is applicable for us also. Next point, perfection. In mathematics, we used to say tending to zero and tending to infinity. In the integration, we put the integration zero to infinity. Tending to zero and then tending to infinity. It is only tending to infinity. It is only tending to zero. Not that it is becoming zero. Not that it is becoming infinity. Nearing to that. So, even Upanayanam word means, Upa means nearer. Nayana means taking to that point. Upanayanam is taking to that point. The absolute point. Upanishat word also the same meaning. Upa means nearer, Nishat means taking you to that point. Taking nearer to that point, not to the point, is impossible. So, as far as now the subject is concerned, nothing in this world is 100% perfect. Nothing in this world is 100% perfect. Nothing in this world is 100% imperfect. Everything is in between these two. Perfection level may be higher, imperfection level may be higher. Only the percentage varies. no man in this world is 100% perfect. No man in this world is 100% perfect. Mata Amritanandamayi used to tell a story. One boy was searching for a perfect girl for marrying. He went the world over, the richest boy from a richest family in Japan. That boy was searching perfect girl. For about 2-3 years he searched, and finally in one airport that boy could meet a girl. A very beautiful dame himself. And he went and discussed with that girl. This boy was also very handsome. Lot of discussion went on. Finally this boy said to that girl, in your words, in your visions, in your behavior, in your beauty aspect, you are perfect. I am searching for a perfect girl for marrying. Would you like to marry me? I would like to marry you. That girl gave a reply, I am searching for a perfect boy for marrying. Because of that, I am targeting a perfect boy, I cannot marry you. What does it mean? I am searching for a perfect boy, so I cannot marry you. It means you are not perfect. Some limitations are also there in you, but I could see from you the limitations, drawbacks, the problems and negatives. So nobody in the world is perfect. You are not perfect, I am not perfect, nobody is in the world perfect. But we can tend nearer to the perfection level. Next point. Many people think that science is the ultimate solution for every problem. No. You know, in Yajurveda, 40th chapter, 9th stanza, 10th and 11th stanzas, mantras, not stanza, mantras give you. Vidyam cha avidyam cha yastat veda ubayam saha avidyaya mrityam tirtva vidyaya mrtam ashnuti. There are two types of knowledge. One vidya, eternal, experiential, spiritual knowledge. Eternal, experiential, spiritual knowledge is vidya. Avidya, external, experimentable, scientific knowledge is avidya. External, experimentable, scientific knowledge is avidya. Avidyaya mrityam tirtva vidyaya mrtam asnuti. Use the scientific knowledge for overcoming the day-to-day problem in our life. Use the scientific knowledge for overcoming the day-to-day problem in our life. And vidyaya mrtam asnuti. Through the spiritual knowledge, attain a mentally peaceful life in your life. Mentally peaceful status in your life. So spiritual knowledge is for a peaceful living. Scientific knowledge is a enriched physical entertaining life. Next line it tells, prior to this what I said, andam tama pravishanti ye avidyamupasate tato bhuyaivate tamo yavuvidyayam ridaha. Those who are thinking that science can solve all the human problem. Those who are thinking that science can solve all human problem, they are leading themselves into blinding darkness. They are leading themselves into blinding darkness. Tato bhuya ivate tamo yavu vidyayam ridaha. Those who are thinking that spirituality can solve all human problem, they are also leading themselves into blinding darkness. So not merely the science, not merely the spirituality can solve your problem. Integrate. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna told, Jnanam vijnana sahidam yat jnatva mukshyate ashubha. All the spiritual knowledge is also to be evaluated through scientific knowledge. Incorporate spiritual knowledge with the scientific knowledge, or scientific knowledge with the spiritual knowledge. after reading Bhagavad Gita, making it thorough in his mind, Albert Einstein also said, science without spirituality is blind. Spirituality without science is lame. He used the word religion instead of spirituality. Science without spirituality is blind. Spirituality without science is lame. So these two are to be integrated. Science is not perfect. Science is systematic. Study of a subject, every time it will be changing, changing, changing. Even the atomic structure, what was proposed earlier in 1930-35, completely changed. Atomic structure has changed, relativity theory has changed, biochemistry has changed, medical science has changed, everything, botany has changed, zoology has changed, environmental science has changed, every subject is changing. So science is not permanent, it is not the ultimate truth, it will be continuously changing. Next point, Bhuta Sankhya. This is an important, interesting thing. You know what is Bhuta Sankhya? Many people used to say there is no science and mathematics or anything in India. Unfortunately, if you do not know about the Bhuta Sankhya, what is Bhuta Sankhya? Is a number system followed in ancient India. In almost all the mathematical and astronomical book, in that book, the Sankhya number system, Earth, Prithvi, Dhara, Dharitri, Shoni, Bhumi, all the word for Earth and synonyms of Earth. That means number one, Moon and the synonyms of Moon, again one. Then Yama is a two. Ashwini means number two. Ashwini Devada, two. Dina means Dina Ratra, two. Guna, Satyogunam, Rajogunam, Tamogunam, three. Rama, Parashurama, Balarama, Sri Rama, three. If somewhere Rama is used, that means three. Agni, Ahavani Agni, Dakshin Agni, Garhavati Agni. So Agni, Anala, Pavaga, the synonym of Agni. That's number three. Number three, Sandhya. Morning Sandhya, noon Sandhya, evening Sandhya. Radha Sandhya, Madhyana Sandhya, Sayam Sandhya. Sandhya means three. Veda, Jnana, Vijnana, all these means four. Wherever Veda word is used, that means four. Whether Rama is used, three. Wherever Agni is used, three. Wherever Ashwini is used, two. Wherever Prithvi is used, one. Where Ampara, Akasha, Gagana, Vana, zero. Shunyakasham. Sky and the synonyms of sky, zero. Panjashara. Shara means five. Panjabhuta. Bhuta means five. Indriya means five. Ritu means six. Rasa means six. Shad Rasa. Wherever six is to be written, Rasa means six. Wherever Ritu is written, that is six. Swara means seven. Saptaswara. Rishi, Sanyasi, Maharshi, all these mean seven. Sapta Rishi. Dik, Disha, eight. Ashtadik. Ashtavasu. Vasu means serpent, Nagam. Serpent. Everything means eight. Nanda means nine. Rendra means nine. In human body, nine holes are there. So Sushida, Vivara, Rendra means nine. Graha means nine. Nanda means, in Nanda dynasty, powerfully great nine kings were there. So Nanda means nine. Ekadasha Rudra. Rudra, Shiva, Parvati Vallabha, Shankara means 11. Dwadasha Surya. Surya, Aditya, Arka, Dinagara, Mitra, all this means 12. Vishwe Deva means 13. Manu means 14. So Sharadri Ramanala Yojanani. Shara means 5. Adri, mountain, means 7. Shara 5. Adri means 7. Rama means 3. Anila means 3. 3375. 3375 is the Yojana, is the circumference of the അറ്റ്മോസ്ഫിയർ ഓഫ് ദി എർത്ത്. വ്യോമ ശൂന്യ ശര അദ്രി ഇന്ദു രന്ദ്ര അദ്രി അദ്രി ശര ഇന്ദ്ര മഹാ നമ്പർ ഓഫ് ഡേയ്സ് ഇൻ എ മഹായുഗ. വ്യോമ മീൻസ് സീറോ, ശൂന്യ മീൻസ് സീറോ. വ്യോമ ശൂന്യ ശര ഫൈവ്, വ്യോമ ശൂന്യ ശര അദ്രി സെവൻ, ഇന്ദു വൺ, ഇന്ദു രന്ദ്ര വ്യോമ ശൂന്യ ശര അദ്രി ഇന്ദു രന്ദ്ര നയൻ, അദ്രി അദ്രി സെവൻ സെവൻ, ശര ഫൈവ്, ഇന്ദവ വൺ വൺ ഫൈവ് സെവൻ നയൻ വൺ സെവൻ സെവൻ ലൈക്ക് ദാറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് വിൽ ബി ഗോയിങ്. So, one word right towards first place, tenth place, hundredth place, thousandth place and so on. If you do not know Buddha Sangya, you will not understand anything about Madheshwara Siddhanta. Lallacharya Chishyadi Vadhidanda, you will not understand anything. Lagu Bhaskariyam, Brihat Bhaskariyam, Bhaskaracharya's work, you will not understand at all. Varaha Mihira's Acharya's Siddhanta Shiromani, Horasha, sorry. Varaha Mihira Acharya's Pancha Siddhantika, or Hore Shastra, you will not understand anything. Arya Siddhanta of Aryabhatta 2, Bhaskaracharya's Leelavadi, or Siddhanta Shiromani Bhaskaracharya 2, 1148 AD, you will not understand anything. So, thousands of mathematical and astronomical books for understanding in Sanskrit. Even though you do not know Sanskrit, you can understand that. But if you do not know Bhuta Sankhya, you will not understand anything. So learning Bhuta Sankhya is the simplest method, 5 minutes enough. But without the knowledge of Bhuta Sankhya, you will not understand anything. Next point. You know, our Prime Minister Narendra Modi is labeled as an anti-Muslim person. Whatever riots took place in Gujarat, all the Congress people and others put all the blame on Modi. And Modi is an anti-Muslim, anti-minority, and it's a torture, RSS, Vishwa Hindu Parishad, Hindutvavadi, so on. But just think, when he went to Saudi Arabia, the capital of Muslim countries, the greatest honor, award, prestigious prize used to be given to many people. This year it was given to Narendra Modi. Muslim country gave the highest national award to Narendra Modi. Similarly, Afghanistan also gave the highest award. Iran also gave the highest award to Narendra Modi. And Sri Narendra Modi yesterday, Afghanistan Prime Minister was telling that we believe Narendra Modi and India 1000 times more than we believe Pakistan and their rulers. So you just see Narendra Modi being labeled as a Hindutvavadi or anti-minority. He could build a fantastic relation with Bangladesh. He could relation with Afghanistan, Iran and UAE. And when he went to Abu Dhabi and the king, the family gave land for building a temple. And wherever he could go, wherever it is Muslim country, they were receiving him with a fantastic clapping and applause. Next point, what are the changes taking place in India? You just think what happened 2 years ago. And now after Modi took the chair of Prime Minister of India, for the last 700 days, you just imagine what are the changes taking place in India. Whether infrastructure, economical level, financial level, industrial level, job opportunity level, facilities available. Just think about it. For the last 60-65 years, what happened? For the last 650 days, what happened? How an individual, if the group is powerful and strong enough to change a nation? His visit to America, his visit to England, his visit to Switzerland, visit to Russia, visit to Australia, Japan, China, and how the FDI is increasing, how the infrastructure facilities are being uplifted. Just to think, whether you are a leftist or a congressman or in any political party, truth is truth, fact is fact, good thing is to be labeled as good things. So, just analyze where our country is going and who is responsible for that. Now, next question, whether God is there or not. You just see our heart is beating 68 times per minute. we are breathing 16 times per minute. Every minute our blood circulates through 60,000 kilometers per minute. 60,000 kilometers per minute. Whatever we are eating in the late evening is completely getting digested and the waste material is coming to the other end of the intestine. And what are the internal changes taking place right from our birth till the death? Same thing is happening in 1.2 million type of animals. Same thing is happening in nearly 4 lakhs type of plants. The internal changes are taking place. In a fertilized egg, the embryo gets converted into a chicken within 19-20 days. No external information is pumped into it. Internally it is doing it. The womb of the mother of every animal, womb of the mother of every animal, once the sperm of the father and egg of the mother unite, once the embryo is formed, that embryo gets converted into giraffe in the womb of a mother giraffe. That embryo gets converted into human body in the mother, human mother. In the womb of an elephant, that embryo gets converted into an elephant. In the tiger, lion, fish, rabbit, cat, dog. In the womb within a specific period, embryo gets converted into that particular baby. What is responsible for this internal change? Hindus call it as Prajnanam Brahma. Awareness and consciousness present in every living and non-living being is called the ultimate God and divine power. It is present in me, so Aham Brahmasmi. It is present in you, so Tat Brahma Tomasi. It is present as a part of Paramatma, as Jivatma, so I am Atma Brahma. So God is not the one which is there in the temple. But for an ordinary man, without directly watching something, he cannot imagine about God. Just like we put Earth as a small globe for the lower primary school. The globe is needed for understanding Earth when you are at lower level. When you are at higher level, a map is enough. Inside the picture is enough. So the God concept is not easy to digest at lower level, for which idol is needed, temple is needed, picture is needed. But when you are elevating into spiritually higher level, na mantra, na tantram, na dhyanam, na shayanam, na yajnopavidam, na dandam, na shikam, nothing is needed. So God is there as awareness and consciousness in every living and non-living beings. Na tatra chakshur gacchadi, it cannot be seen through your eyes. Na vak gacchadi, it cannot be explained by words. No manaha, it cannot be mentally felt. Na vidmo, what is exactly God, nobody knows about it. Na vidmo, na vijanimo, nobody can specifically teach that. Very difficult to teach that. So, God is the one beyond imagination. So that is explained as yato vacho nivartande aprapya manasasaha. The God cannot be mentally perceived, so it cannot be explained through words. That's Upanishadic words. But God is there because of that divine power beyond the level of imagination. Eka evahi bhutatma bhute bhute vyavastita ekada bahuda chaiva drishyate jalachandravata. That Paramatma Chaitanyam is only one. Only one. But it is manifested in every living beings. As far as Hindus are concerned, bhute bhute vyavastita, living and non-living being, it is manifested. It is just like that. A moon is there in the sky. One and only one moon is there. But the reflection of the moon can be seen in ocean, in river, in pond, in well, in a cup of tea. The reflection of the moon can be seen. Drishyate jala chandravata. Just like Chandran can be seen in a water, jala suryavata, Suryan can be seen in water. We can see that the manifestation of the divine power is there. Vishwadas chakshuruda vishwada omugo vishwada omaguruda vishwada spada tam bahupyam namadi sampadatrayhi dhyava prativi janayan deva eka. All the celestial bodies including earth got created by that divine power. There's only one and only one, deva eka. That divine power we call it as God. Now, next one. Next point. There is a Malayalam movie Kalapani. Kalapani is connected with Andaman Nicobar Island. If you are going to Andaman Nicobar Island, you can see that. The olden days, how much sufferings the Indians had for getting the freedom. How the Britishers and the Japanese people, the military people, tortured Indians. If you want to see that, you have to go to Andaman and Nicobar Island. Andaman Island particularly. Now, we have got a wrong impression that the Britishers united India. Politically, they might have united Indians as India is made and Pakistan got carved out of it. And Bangladesh also carved out of it. But India was one. India is one. India will be one. Himalayam samarabhya yavat indussarovaram tam devanarmitam desham hindustanam prachakshate. Right from Himalaya up to Indian Ocean. Whatever earth nation is that, that is known as Hindustanam. Asindo sindhu paryantam yasya bharata bhumikaha matrabhu pitrabhu punyabhu karmabhu jnanabhu chaiva samayi hinduriti smrita. Those who are thinking that land, the nation, Bharata, as their motherland, fatherland, holy land, and karma bhumi, jnana bhumi, they are known as Hindus. India was one, India is one culturally. So-called politically, that so-called political system arose only decades ago. Politically we may be different. That too not that much different. Indians used to go from south to north, north to south. Indians used to visit Kedarnath, Badrinath, Amarnath, Vaishnava Devi Temple, Kali Temple of Calcutta. Similarly, Jagannath Temple of Orissa, Srinivasa Temple of Andhra. People used to come to Guruvayur Temple from time immemorial. So Indians never have had any inhibition in walking from south corner to the north corner. We used to go to Ganga, used to Gaya and Trivani for performing Shraddha. North Indians used to come to Rameshwaram, Kanyakumari for performing Shraddha. So culturally we were united. Politically, unity was not at all under our consideration. Vividhata me mekata. Unity in diversity, not created by the Westerners, but we create. Now, about the conversion. Very serious conversions are going on throughout India. Throughout India, very serious conversions are going on. Through crooked and cheating, by misinterpreting the Vedas, misinterpreting our Bhavishya Purana, Christians are spreading the fraud and the wrong cheating messages that Jesus Christ was born for removing the sin of the people. My sin cannot be removed by anybody else. If I am a sinner, for removing my sin, if somebody else is hanged in the cross, that is not logic. For every good action, there is an equal and opposite good reaction. For every bad action, there is an equal and opposite bad reaction that is to be experienced by the individual. If I commit a murder, its punishment cannot be given to somebody else. If I cheat somebody, that sin of cheating somebody cannot be transferred to somebody else. So now Christians are converting Hindus, poor Hindus, by all crooked method, telling that Jesus Christ was born for removing your sin. Jesus Christ was born and died. Jesus Christ got crucified for your sin. So once crucifixion is over, my sin should be over. How it is not over? continuously cheating is going on. Every human being is treated as sinner. Then many saints are there now for Christianity. Those saints, when they were living in India, in the world, as human being, they were sinners. Pope is a human being, he is also sinner. How one sinner can be elevated into saint by another sinner? The humble story of Jesus Christ. The cross, it is used for crucifying Jesus Christ, the holy man. That cross is taken as a holy thing, holy cross. People used to put the cross in the neck. People used to put the holy cross in the church. Is it not just like worshipping the pistol used for killing Mahatma Gandhi? It is just like using the pistol for an emblem of worshipping or sacred thing. The pistol used for killing the father of the nation. And in churches, the blood of Jesus is taken as wine. Or reverse, wine is taken as the blood of the Jesus. If you are worshipping Jesus Christ, how can you drink the blood of Jesus Christ? And bread is taken as the body of Jesus. If you are worshipping Mahavishnu, Lord Krishna, Ayyappa, or Bhagavati, Devi, or Muruga, Subramanya, can you eat his body as bread? How can you do it? You know, Jesus Christ was crucified for the Adi Babam, the sin performed by somebody else. What was the Adi Babam? You know, Adam disobeyed the God and ate the Jnana Kani, knowledge of apple, apple of knowledge. Adam and Eve ate the apple. They realized that they are naked. The God came and asked them, where you are hiding. Then Adam and Eve told the God, Jehovah, we ate the apple of knowledge, so we realized that we are naked. Then the God cursed them. And what was the ultimate aim of the God then? God wanted these two people walk in the naked way. Satan really advised them and made them aware that they are naked. So they started covering their sexual part using the wood, bark or the leaves. Suppose the Satan would not have advised like this. If these two people followed only the God, even the Christians in India would have been walking naked. Luckily the Satan advised and they came to know that they are naked and they are using nowadays the cloth for covering the body. So is Satan good or the God good? And you know, Adam and Eve, they came together through intercourse, they got Cain, the son. The son married another girl. From where that the second girl came? God created only Adam and Eve. How the Cain got a girl? Cain got a girl and married, and their son, they got a son Ephraim, he also married. How the third girl came? Fourth person, how did it come? After that, the God told the Jacob, go to Egypt and destroy the worshipping places of the people living in Egypt. So people were there in Egypt before Adam and Eve. All this humbug, nonsense, crude and fraud story are utilized for selling Jesus Christ. Jesus never died in the cross. And in Bible it says, when you are searching for the living man in the among the dead body. So he has not never died. But now in India, the story of Jesus is being spread in such a way that poor Hindus are being cheated and getting converted into Christianity through Dhyana Kendra, meditation center and so on. Why I said this to you now? Just to make you understand that Hindu Dharma has got fantastic knowledge in it. Let you be a Jnana Yogi. You learn Hindu Dharma. Learning should be done for teaching others. Learning and teaching should be done for preaching. Learning, teaching, preaching should be done for practicing. And for acting and reacting those who are working against Hindus. You know, all the 10 avatars over for protecting Hindu Dharma, I and you should become an avatara. We cannot give the responsibility to some organization, some movement, or a particular sect of people. We have to take the responsibility of protecting our Dharma through Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga, and Bhakti Yoga. All the three are needed. Jnana Yoga is the one which is first needed. Learn about Hindu Dharma and thoroughly teach others. Karma Yoga, do your action. Become a Karma Yogi. And act and react wherever it is needed. Conversion is the most vulnerable thing taking place in India. And Pope has told first millennia for converting England and Europe. Second millennia, America and Africa. Third millennia, from 2000 AD onwards, India, China and Asian countries should be completely converted. 1949, the Pope said, when he came to Bombay, he said, as long as you are a minority, use the benefits available for the minority to rule the majority. When you become the majority, use the power of majority to rule the then minority. Christians are doing the same thing. And you know, 2000 AD, when Atal Bihari Vajpayee was ruling India as Prime Minister, the Pope said what I told you earlier. First millennia for the Europe, second millennia for America and Africa, third millennia we have to convert India by hooks or crooks. Never allow that. Bring back all those who have gone to Christianity from Hindu Dharma. Teach them. Do your work. They need not learn all Vedas, Upanishads and other things. Merely once or twice or thrice in a week going to temple, doing some morning and evening prayer, lighting the lamp. That is enough for an ordinary Hindu. So it's your duty to learn as much as possible for bringing back our culture values without getting it perished through crooked methods adopted by minorities for converting. Hindus are minority in Kerala. Hindus are minority in Jammu and Kashmir. Hindus are zero in Nagaland, Mizoram, Meghalaya, and has become less than 40% in Arunachal Pradesh, less than 60% in Assam. The number of Hindus steeply decreased in Bengal. Conversion is severely going on throughout India, but nobody is knowing that one. I gave these many explanations to see that one. Our India is to be protected, and our culture is to be protected, our basic knowledge is to be protected. All those who are watching this YouTube uploading material, I am not against any Christian, I am not against any Muslim, I am against the churchianity which is converting poor Hindus, exploiting their ignorance by cheating crooked method, adopting that by paying money, by praying for them, and by creating all type of nonsense. Poor Hindus are getting converted to Christianity. Learn that, boldly oppose it, be a good Hindu and be an excellent Indian. Work for India, work for our society, work for our culture, work for our family, work for ourselves, our family, our culture, our society, our nation should get sustainable and permanent benefit from your work also. Thank you very much. My pranams to you.